viewers and friends. You have joined us throughout the week, and we have given heaven thanks and praise for the fact that you have been with us throughout the week. We pray that you have been tremendously blessed. I am Jason Peters, one of the pastors here on the island of Barbados.
And I am Trudy Peters.
Tonight, we are so very privileged to be hosting the final episode in this timely and God-sent My Forever Friend evangelistic campaign. We pray that you were blessed as you went night after night with us. There has been a registration link, there has been a prayer link, and tonight that registration link and prayer link are still available. If you feel impressed, if you want us to pray for you, if you want to have Bible studies, we ask that you contact us through those links, and we pray that God's blessings will truly rest and abide upon you in a very special way. Throughout the past week, we have been building friendships with each other as you have used the links in the YouTube chat to register and to make prayer requests. But most importantly, each of us have been able to build or deepen our friendship with Jesus Christ, who, unlike some of our earthly friends, has promised never to leave us. He says, "I am with you always. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you."
That is so true. I want to join with Jason in welcoming you to tonight's worship, the final one in this series. We are happy that you are here. I love the song that says, "I found a friend, oh, such a friend. He drew me with the cords of love, and thus he bound me to him." Jesus is the one we can count on beyond the shadow of a doubt. He wants to bind us to himself, and if we hold on to him, we are assured that we will live with him forever in heaven one day. That thought makes me want to shout hallelujah. So let's get some practice in. Let's join with the praise team after we have invited Jesus to be with us once again.
Shall we pray? Our Father, who art in heaven, glory to your matchless name. Tonight we ask that you forgive us of all sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We are grateful for how your Holy Spirit has led this program, My Forever Friend, from the opening night to tonight, the final night of the series. We praise your heavenly name for all of the persons who would have heard these precious messages and for all the souls that would have said yes to follow you and have given their lives to you. We commit tonight's program, the preacher, and all the proceedings into your care. Take full control, Lord, as you have so many times before. And we thank you in advance for all the manifested miracles and for all the battles won. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen.
Spirit share, we seek a seat yet to come, I hear the people say. Brethren, as we prepare for our Lord's soon return, let's sing this song together.
Yeah. Hello, fellow Barbadians, and a special hello to our regional neighbors who might be viewing this video as well. For those of you who might not know me, I am Dr. Bentley Yao. I'm a medical registrar in the Department of Internal Medicine at the Queen Elizabeth Hospital here in Barbados. I'm also a member of the COVID-19 medical ICU team at our primary isolation facility called Harrison's Point. Also, for the year of 2021, I've been asked to serve as the Health Ministry's Director at the Ebenezer Seventh-day Adventist Church, and it's through that position that I've been asked to speak to you very briefly for the next 2 minutes on COVID-19, the symptoms of COVID-19, and the rationale for vaccination. So let's begin. The first thing I want to establish is, what is COVID-19? COVID-19 is a clinical condition caused by a novel virus known as Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus 2, or SARS-CoV-2. This virus was first discovered in the city of Wuhan in China in December of 2019. The virus, like the strains that we've been hearing a lot about in the media, the UK, the Brazilian and South African strain, is highly infectious and it spreads to persons from person to person via what we call respiratory droplets. So an infected person, when they cough, they sneeze or they talk, can spread the virus to others, whether the virus might be suspended in the air or it lands on the surface, and then an uninfected individual touches that contaminated surface or is exposed to the individual without wearing a mask, and these virus particles can then land or they can then infect you via your eyes, your nose or your mouth. Once infected, the individual have what we call an incubation period, so they can start to show symptoms as early as 2 days or as late as 14 days. And they themselves can infect others up to 10 days if they're asymptomatic or have no symptoms, up to 14 days if they do have symptoms, and even up to 20 days if they're in an ICU facility or require mechanical ventilation. These symptoms typically would be shortness of breath, fever, runny nose, lack of appetite, lack of taste, and lack of smell. And some people can even be asymptomatic. And the second thing I want to talk about is, despite our best efforts and despite learning a lot about the virus over the past year, why is coronavirus still a major problem today? And it's still a major problem because we as individuals in the population and as countries and as nations, we need to do our part. What do I mean by doing our part? How do we beat the virus? Simple. One, we physical distance of at least 6 feet from anyone who doesn't share the same household. Two, we wear a mask where it covers the nose, the mouth, and the chin. We wash our hands regularly and or sanitize our hands with solutions containing at least 60 to 70% alcohol. And then finally, we vaccinate. And the people ask often, why do we vaccinate? And we vaccinate because it allows us to prepare the population or to allow the population to develop antibodies against an infectious agent, in this case coronavirus, so that they can be able to fight off the virus if they do become infected without actually having the full symptoms or the full severity of that illness. So that's what vaccination does. And if you become vaccinated with COVID, the COVID-19 vaccine, we can be able to reduce the cases. We can be able to reduce the morbidity or the severity of the disease if one was to be infected with coronavirus. And we most importantly would be able to reduce the mortality or the number of deaths from COVID-19. So it is my plea from myself to you, anyone who might be listening or viewing this video, to do the right thing. Physical distance, wear the mask, sanitize your hands and wash your hands regularly, and most importantly, get vaccinated. So until we meet again, stay safe and God bless.
Your perfect plan, gave me my ears. I can hear your voice so clear. I can hear the cries of sinners, but can I wipe away their tears? You gave me my voice to speak your word, to sing of all your praises to those who've never heard. But with my eyes I see a need for more availability. I see hearts that have been broken, so many people to be free. Oh Lord, I'm available. Say to use me, Lord, to show someone the way and enable me to say, my storage is empty and I am available. The tools you gave to me, my hands, my ears, my voice, my eyes, so you can use them as you please. I have emptied out my cup so that you can fill it up, and now I'm free and I just wanna be more available to you. Lord, I'm available to you. My will I give to you. I'll do what you say to use me, show someone the way and enable me to say, my storage is empty and I am available.
2 Corinthians 9:7, the King James Version reads, "Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver." Isn't it wonderful to know that God cares about how we feel? And it is also important to remember that He has asked us to share His messages with others. We may carry out this commission by pledging to support His work and send our gift to the East Caribbean Conference of Seventh-day Adventists via the bank details on your screen. For the benefit of our listening audience, however, the bank information is as follows. For Barbados, the bank is the Bank of Nova Scotia, Scotia Bank. The transit number is 40055. The account number is 00005006. I'll repeat those numbers. The transit number is 40055. The account number is 00005006. For our overseas viewers who wish to forward their gift to the Barbados account, please include the SWIFT code NOSCBBBB. I'll repeat that code, NOSCBBBB. For Dominica, the bank name is the National Bank of Dominica. The account number is 10069204. The SWIFT code is NCDMDMDM. That information once again. The account number is 10069204. The SWIFT code NCDMDMDM. Thank you for your offerings and gifts. Do continue to enjoy the service.
Gracious God and Father in heaven, we are so thankful for this wonderful privilege and opportunity to return unto you what is rightfully yours. You have granted us the privilege and the opportunity to labor. And we pray, Lord, that as we return these gifts to you, that you will use them to further the gospel, that men and women may come to know you as Lord and Savior. Bless those who give, those who may not have to give. Bless them also that in time to come, they will be able to. But most of all, bless us as we give ourselves to you, that you can use us along with our gifts. And may heaven rejoice because men and women come to know you as Lord and Savior on behalf of these gifts. Accept them as we offer, and accept us as we give ourselves to you. Hear from heaven now and answer our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, tonight, the person who's been chosen by God to bless us with that final message in this beautiful series is Pastor Anthony Hoyte. He's one of our pastors here in Barbados. He has served the East Caribbean Conference as a pastor, as a youth director as well. And tonight, the man of God, Pastor Anthony Hoyte, will bless our hearts as we listen to that final message in this all-important series. Pastor Hoyte.
Lord, you hear me when I call. Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me. It's amazing. Who am I that you are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call. Is it true that you are thinking of me?
When I call,
it's amazing. Oh, I am a friend of God.
Pleasant good evening to everyone. Such a delight to be with you this evening as we bring this program to a close, this being the final night of this series. And I am certainly happy to be with you tonight, to be able to share this last message in this current series. To all my friends out there, I extend a very
warm and cordial welcome to you. And to all our members, we say welcome. Tonight, I am going to be looking at a very interesting topic. I'm going to be looking and focusing on the topic, Home at Last with My Best Friend. Home at Last with My Best Friend. Shall we pray? Gracious God and our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this privilege that we have where we can open your word to study again tonight. We pray that your Holy Spirit will come divinely close. We pray that you will give understanding. We pray that you will so enlighten our minds that we may be able to catch a glimpse of glory tonight. And may excite us and thrill us to the point where we would long with eager anticipation for that day when we shall be with you to enjoy your presence forevermore. May your Holy Spirit take control of my mind and my lips, and may every utterance that is made, Lord, be used in such a way as to paint word pictures that will help the imagination of those who are here tonight listening to this message to catch a glimpse of glory. I ask in the name of Jesus with thanksgiving. Amen. Home at last with my best friend. I met her on the campus of the University of the Southern Caribbean. But it was not until 3 years later, as co-workers in the Department of Student Services, that we became better acquainted. Upon graduating in 1996 and approximately 1 week away from my return to Barbados, I asked her if she will be my special friend, to which she agreed. We enjoyed and endured a long-distance courtship for 2 years and were happily married in June of 1998 in the Tonopona Seventh-day Adventist Church. After God, she became my best friend. Following a delightful honeymoon, she joined me in the southern Grenadine islands of St. Vincent, where I was stationed, having been assigned my first pastoral district in the Grenadines. I had responsibility for two churches and one group on the island of Union and Canawan. Travel between the islands was frequent and often lasted between 2 to 4 days. I remember the first time I was about to leave home on one of my church trips. We were up at 4 a.m. in the morning. I needed to be on the pier for 6 a.m. to catch the boat. And when it was time to leave home, I embraced her and she me. Then came the tears flowing from her eyes. She cried and cried and cried. My heart sunk as I thought of leaving her behind. That morning, I almost missed the boat. And believe me, when I say that that day was the longest day of my life, and the night was the longest night. But we endured, and then came the day when I was about to return home. My wife asked the day before if I had already packed, and she told me in no uncertain terms, I better not miss the boat. On arrival, she was at the pier to meet me. There were scores of people present, but neither of us took note of any of them. We were overjoyed to be together again. We traveled home, enjoyed a special meal together under candlelight, which she had prepared. Let's just say it was a very special time to be home at last with my best friend. This evening, I wish to speak to you about another homecoming, the most anticipated, magnificent, exhilarating too good to be absent from homecoming you could ever imagine. Oh yes, my friends, I'm talking about the reward of those who have made Jesus Christ their best friend and have chosen to demonstrate their love and loyalty to him by following his word and going all the way with him into the watery grave of baptism. Over the past week, you have heard how Satan came and robbed us of our dominion. But thank God, Jesus Christ, man's best friend, came and died on the cross so that what was taken from us can be restored to us. Amen. You have heard about the importance of developing a solid relationship with him, one that is confirmed through the covenant of water baptism, one that allows him to transform our lives into the persons that he would have us to become. Amen. You have heard that with such a trustworthy and faithful friend on your side, in the pre-Advent judgment, you have no cause neither to fear nor worry about the outcome, for everything is going to be all right. You have heard that this friend has gone to prepare a place for his friends, and that he has promised that he will come again. Would somebody say amen? You have heard why he must come, how he will come, to whom he will come. What you have not been told is when he will come. You see, nobody knows neither the day nor the hour when he will come. Hence the need for us to prepare. You have heard that this friend has had a faithful following throughout the centuries, and today he still has faithful followers. Yes. Faithful friends who demonstrate their loyalty by keeping the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ. You have heard that the end of this world is at hand. Soon Jesus Christ will return to the earth to gather his saints. It is then that the separation will take place. The unrighteous living will be struck down at the brightness of his coming, to sleep the sleep of death with the unrighteous dead who will remain asleep in their graves, while the righteous, yes, the friends of Jesus, get to spend 1,000 years in heaven with him. What a wonderful experience that will be. You have heard about the real danger of putting off the decision to make Jesus Christ your best friend before it's too late. You do understand that eternal issues are at stake here, don't you? Well, what's left for me to tell? Come go with me on a tour to the home that my best friend is preparing for those who make him their best friend. Can I tell you something before we go? 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 9, the Bible declares,
But as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the things which God have prepared for them that love him.
Oh yes, this passage of scripture makes it abundantly clear that what I am about to share with you has not been fully comprehended by any mortal being. Yet God has given to us snippet views of the home he is preparing for his friends. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay, let's continue. Revelation chapter 20, verses 7 and 8. Read it.
And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea.
This, my friends, is at the end of the 1,000 years, which the friends of Jesus get to spend in heaven. The wicked and the unbelieving who sleep the sleep of death during that period are now resurrected, and Satan goes out for the final time before his destruction to lead them astray as he previously did all their lives. Verse 9 states, reader.
And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about, and the beloved city and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them.
Mm-hmm. What camp of the saints? The beloved city is the Apostle John talking about here. If we go to Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, we find the answer to that question. Reader?
And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city.
Holy city.
A new Jerusalem.
New Jerusalem.
Coming down from God.
Coming where?
Down from heaven. From God's
from
rather.
From God.
Out of heaven.
Uh-huh.
Prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
I want you to see it with your mind's eye. The holy city, New Jerusalem, descends from heaven. Inside the city is Jesus, man's best friend, along with the saved, those who have lived to serve Jesus. On the outside of the walls of the city are the wicked dead who have been resurrected to be judged. Satan leads them to believe that they can take the city, that they can dethrone Christ and take the city from the saints. And being deceived, they act upon his words, and at that instance, the Bible tells us fire issues forth from God the Father out of heaven and destroys them. Yet Satan, the evil angels, and the wicked and unbelieving, this, my friends, is the second death from which there is no resurrection. My intent is not to scare anyone. Rather, it is to present you with the realities of the choices that we make here. And now, those who make Jesus their best friend spend an eternity of bliss with him, while those who choose to remain in their sinful condition will have no eternity to spend. There will be none. They will be blotted out of existence forever. I veered off the bit, but let's come back to our topic tonight. What has been revealed about that city, the New Jerusalem, that should excite us and cause us to desire to be there? I've taken note of at least three things that I wish to share with you this evening. Number one, it is out of this world, both literally and figuratively. I'm going to ask the reader to read again for us Revelation chapter 21 and verse 2. Revelation chapter 21, verse 2.
And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
Oh yes, literally, it descends from God out of heaven. That's why I say it's out of this world. But
amen.
Figuratively, it is beyond description. John says in describing it, it is adorned as a bride for her husband. Secondly, it is magnificent in appearance, to say the least. Revelation chapter 21, verses 10, 14, 18, 19, and 21. Read it for us, reader.
And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. verse 14 says, and the wall of the city had 12 foundations,
mm-hmm.
and in them the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. Verse 18, and the building of the wall of it was of jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass.
Mm-hmm. You want to repeat that?
Like unto clear glass.
Oh, yes.
And the foundation of the wall of the city were garnished with the manner of with all manner of precious stones.
Uh-huh.
The first foundation was jasper, mm-hmm. the second sapphire, the third a chalcedony, the fourth an emerald. And verse 21 says, and the 12 gates were 12 pearls.
Wow.
Each several gate was of one pearl, and the streets of the city was pure gold, as it were transparent glass.
Thank you so much. Yeah, now, you know, when I proposed to the lady who is now my darling wife, it was with a gold ring set with emerald stones. And she was blown away. But in that city, the Bible tells us that the streets
yes,
are made
yes,
of pure gold.
Yes.
And while we sometimes become fascinated and blown away by some precious stones like emeralds yeah. and beryls and topaz and so on,
diamond.
We understand that those stones will make up the foundation of yes. the walls.
Yes, yes, true.
Huh. You can begin to imagine what it's going to be like.
That's right.
A third thing that I want to share with you is that it is a wonder of wonders.
Right.
A wonder of wonders. Revelation chapter 21, verses 23, 25, and chapter 22 and verse 5. Read it for us, reader. Revelation chapter 21, verses 23 and 25.
And the city had no need of the sun,
mm-hmm.
neither of the moon,
yes.
to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof.
Mm-hmm.
And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there. Revelation 22:5 says, and there shall be no night there,
mm-hmm.
and they need no candle, neither light of the sun, for the Lord God giveth them light, and they shall reign forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. What a wonderful picture is presented to us here.
That's right.
Understand this, that in that city that descends from God out of heaven, the Shekinah glory that went with the Israelites, that presence that was with them during their sojourn in the wilderness will attend the presence of the dwellers of that celestial land.
Oh, yes.
So that there will be no need of the light of the sun or of the moon, because the Lord, who is the light, will lighten that place. You know, sometimes when I read those accounts in the Bible, in the Old Testament, how I wish that I was there, but I understand that I will get the opportunity to see the Shekinah glory as it was displayed.
Yes.
Oh, what a wonder.
Wow, what a wonder.
What a wonder that's going to be. Now, that's just the city. That's just the city where Jesus dwells with his friends, and where the redeemed, we are told in Isaiah chapter 66, shall gather from Sabbath to worship. But what about the rest of the habitation of the saints? The new earth that John saw according to Revelation chapter 21 and verse 1. The prophet Isaiah recorded some 7 centuries earlier in Isaiah chapter 65 and verse 17. Reader.
For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered nor come into mind.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 21 says, and they shall build houses
and
inhabit them.
Inhabit them. In other words, we're not going to have a situation like we do here where sometimes people build houses and then die and don't get to enjoy the fruits of their labors. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
They will do what? Build houses and?
Inhabit them.
Inhabit them. Continue.
And they shall plant vineyards.
They will plant vineyards and?
Eat the fruit of them.
Eat the fruit of them. Mm-hmm. We won't have to worry there about thieves.
That's right.
We won't have to worry there about monkeys that come and fake and then destroy the remainder of the crops.
Yes, sir.
We will plant vineyards and eat the fruits of them. Yes. Verse 22.
They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree are the days of my people, and mine elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands.
Verse 25.
The wolf and the lamb shall feed together.
Yes.
And the lion shall eat straw like the bullock. The dust shall be the serpent's meat. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountains. Thus saith the Lord.
Amen. And if God says it, I guarantee you that it is so.
It is so, yes.
What is painted here for us is a picture of such harmony, such peace and tranquility that will exist in that place that our best friend has gone to prepare for us, that we will not have to worry about the things that we now worry about.
That's right.
About thieves and robbers, are you with me? About crime and violence and all of these things. God has promised that he will make all things new.
Amen.
But I also like Isaiah chapter 35. Isaiah chapter 35 verses 6. 35 verses 5, 6, and 10. Read it for us, reader. Isaiah chapter 35 verses 5, 6, and 10.
Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened.
The eyes of the
blind
shall be
opened.
Open.
And the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped.
Unstopped.
Then shall lame man leap as a hart, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out, and streams in the desert.
Verse 10.
And the ransom of the Lord shall return, and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. What a picture. What a picture is being painted here. For we understand that in that land, the earth made new, there will be no need for doctors.
That's right.
There'll be no need for miracle workers healers.
Right.
There'll be no need for undertakers.
Yes, tell us, preacher.
No need for undertakers and funeral parlors. None of that.
None
of that. No
yes,
need
sir.
For it.
All right.
Because the Lord God will be in the mix of his people.
Yes.
And they will enjoy the good things that the Lord has in store for them.
Amen.
But I get a little more excited when I turn to the last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 21. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 4.
Right.
Revelation 21, verse 4. What does it say to us, reader?
And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes.
How many tears?
All tears.
All tears from their eyes.
And there shall be no more death. Neither sorrow nor crying. Neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are passed away.
Praise the Lord. The former things.
Yes, former things.
Are passed away. The former things. Are no more.
That's right.
The former things.
Yes.
Gone forever.
Gone, yes.
Are you seeing the picture, friends?
We're seeing it.
Are you seeing the picture I am seeing?
Yes, sir.
What a glorious picture of heaven and the new earth that is presented in the Word of God. A place where there will be no more agitation. No more Botheration, pardon me if that sounds a bit Beijing. More castigation, no more discrimination and extrication, no more frustration, no more gestation, no more hallucination, no more infestation and lamentation, no more mortification, no more negotiation, no more overexertion, no more provocation, no more superstition, no more transgression, no more usurpation and vexation. But I tell you that in that land, there will only be jubilation and celebration. Heaven and the new earth will be a realization.
Oh,
I say, Lord, help me. I want to be there.
Me too.
I've got to be there to be home at last with my best friend. This evening, as this program comes to a close, maybe there are individuals still who should have made the decision to give their lives to Christ and to go all the way with him in baptism together with those who have done so yesterday, but you have not. If there are any such persons listening, I wish to give you the opportunity to do so tonight. While you linger, Jesus is still knocking at your heart's door. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 20 states, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me." He wants to have fellowship with you. He wants to be your best friend and to have you spend the ceaseless ages of eternity with him. Why don't you let him? Why don't you take him as your Lord and Savior this very moment while I pray? Oh, Father and our God, we thank you so much this evening for giving us a glimpse of that home that you have gone to prepare for us. A place, Lord, where you long to be with your people and to have your people dwelling in your presence and enjoying life to the fullest as you created man too when you placed them in the Garden of Eden. We ask, O gracious Father, that you will create in our hearts a burning desire, a longing to be with you. May we see the necessity of making our calling and election sure. May we choose this day to make you our best friend, so that when that time comes, when you will make up your jewels, your precious jewels, you will gather your people from all across the globe, that because we have chosen you as our best friend, we would be gathered and we would have the privilege of living and dwelling with you throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity. Tonight, Lord, there may be some who have not yet made that decision, but tonight some string in their hearts have been touched. Some desire has been created and they long to have such an experience. And I ask even now as I pray, oh God, that you will help them to reach out the arms of faith and to grasp your hands and to take hold of you and what you desire to give them. Lord, may they see and the importance of making you their best friend now, so that when you come, they may have a part with you. And I pray that tonight, that person who is making that decision for Jesus, that person who is deciding, yes, I want to be there. I want to be able to walk the streets of gold and see my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and dwell with him throughout eternity. I pray that you will take them and that you will seal them and that you would help them, Lord, to commit their lives to you, even in going all the way into the watery grave of baptism. And I pray that you will make this a reality for those persons tonight, even as they make that choice for you. Thank you, O God, for moving upon their hearts and for leading them to this decision. And we give you, O God, all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. In Jesus' precious name, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Friends, if you have made that decision to receive Jesus as your Savior, please give us a call. The number is on the screen. Or contact us using the link provided. I guarantee you, you will not be sorry that you did. God bless you, and do have a wonderful night. In Jesus' name.
We have been especially blessed tonight. Our hearts were watered as we listened to the Word of God. We pray that the Word of God finds a lodging place in your heart. We pray that tonight Jesus, the friend of sinners, will also be your friend. We want to thank you, viewers, for worshiping with us night after night this week. We want to remind you that this is the final message in the series. They are available on YouTube. Please feel free to watch them over and over again. But most importantly, we want to remind you that Jesus is coming soon, and it is very important that he be your friend. So God bless you in a special way.
Thank you for joining us each night. May God continue to bless you as you deepen your friendship with him. Good night.